Good afternoon. I'm Mabel Wilson. I'm a professor of architecture here at the Graduate School of Architecture Planning and Preservation. I'm also the chair of the steering committee for Studio X. And this is the first of a series that we wanted to do to have a kind of a conversation with Studio X directors and curators and architects within their respective regions. And so talking about architectural practice and trying to kind of do a comparative conversation around particular topics and issues. And it also is emerging out of both conversations that have happened amongst the various Studio X directors and curators. One of them was Housing the Majority, which sort of dealt with issues about housing in these particular sites. And so it's a kind of continuation of some of those threads and those themes. And so I just want to make a brief introduction of Impo Matsipa and Pedro Rivera. We're going to be joined by Marta Moriera of MMBB in Sao Paulo, and Heinrich Wolf and Ilza Wolf from Cape Town, South Africa. And so just a little bit about Pedro Rivera, who will be having a conversation with Marta first. Pedro has taught at the PUC in Rio, the University Espacio de Sa. He's also a partner in Rua Arquitetos with Pedro Evora. His work and research examines globalized cities and how they can be resignified, particularly the recent urban interventions of FIFA and the Olympics in Rio that flooded the city with global financing and tourists, and also architecture and urbanism, but disrupting the already frayed imbalances of poverty and wealth, public space and policing, ecology and development. He has contributed to several international exhibitions, including most recently the Brazilian Pavilion at the recent Venice Biennale. As the director of Studio X Rio, he has been deeply engaged in bringing architects and developers, academics, and government officials together to exchange both local and global viewpoints. His conversation with Marta Moreira, he will actually give an introduction to her, will be followed by Impo Matsipa, who is an adjunct assistant professor of architecture here at GSAP. She's the curator of Studio X Johannesburg. She's also a researcher at the Wits City Institute at the University of Witwatersrand in South Africa. Trained as an architect and historian, Impo's research has been recognized through several prestigious awards, including a Fulbright Scholarship and a Carnegie Grant. Her work has been shortlisted at two national design competitions. Her critical essays and reviews explore public art, culture, spatial justice, inequalities, globalizations, and race and representation in African cities. She has curated several exhibitions, including the South African Pavilion at the 11th International Architectural Exhibition at the Venice Biennale. And she has been most recently the curator of Studio X Johannesburg, which has served as an experimental public platform of architecture in the city. So, I want to start with Pedro, who will introduce Marta.
Thank you. Thank you, Mabel. I just want to make a very short introduction about the context of Brazil. Brazil, I mean, as you probably know, it's one of the largest countries in the world. It's more than 200 million people, and it's basically also an urban country. More than 85% of Brazilian population lives in cities. It's also a very, very unequal society. And this inequality has a series of impacts within cities, within the challenge that the cities have. Services and infrastructures are, of course, are not well distributed in all the city. And many times, people have to manage those things by themselves. It's a kind of either by building infrastructure, either by managing infrastructure. State is very weak in some regions of the country. And of course, I mean, housing has a crucial role on this. Housing is a central topic, and is a topic that we've been investigating, not only at Studio X Rio, but across Studio X, and Impo is also investigating this. And in the actual moment, we've been working with this for about 2 years, but in the actual moment, we're looking into social housing. So, inviting Marta Here was also an opportunity to deeper look at this. The project that Marta will show is Jardim Edith, which is a carefully designed social housing complex located in the central area of São Paulo. In a context of Brazil that focuses in housing production in the peripheries, somehow this project challenges what is being built in the country. I think that her contribution becomes, Marta's contribution here is even more relevant when we think about the context of events in the globe. So I also want to bring that to the table. Her office was founded in 1991 by Fernando Melo Franco, Milton Braga, and Marta Moreira herself. Their former partners include Angelo Butti and Vinicius Gorgatti. Fernando is actually licensed to be the office, licensed for the office to be the Secretary of Urban Development of the City of São Paulo. So this is just to give also for you a little bit of understanding of their engagement with the context of the city and how can it work. They all graduated at the São Paulo State School of Architecture, which is it was a very experimental school founded by Artigas, a leading architecture and thinker in Brazil. And it's also among their main contributions of Artigas was Paulo Mendes da Rocha, which you probably know it. It's a Pritzker Prize architect. And I think their work is really rooted in that tradition. And I mean, not only MMBB works, but there is a series of offices in São Paulo which are deeply rooted in this tradition, and they have been bringing this to the present times. One of the main collaborations between Paulo Mendes is the recently opened Museu dos Coches in Lisbon. Well, Marta is a professor also. She teaches at the Escola da Cidade in São Paulo since 2001 and was a guest professor at Faculdade de Arquitetura e Desenho in Santiago, in Chile. So I would like to welcome Marta.
It's a pleasure to be here with you, and I thank Columbia University for the invitation. Because the difficulty with the language, I'm going to read, I'm sorry. And if I have some difficulties or if it's not clear enough, you can interrupt and ask. So, Jardim Edith was a project made by MMBB in association with H+F, that's another office. I'm here to speak about the Jardim Edith housing project, but before, I would like to show you some images of São Paulo and to talk a little about the city, in order that you know better the context in which this work was developed. So that's an image of one of the buildings of Jardim Edith when it was recently finished. This is a photo from the Copan window. Copan is a building in the center of São Paulo, a project by Niemeyer. And I like very much this photo that was taken by Milton, my partner, and it shows very much the density of the city. As a first characteristic, I think we could say that São Paulo is a modern city. Although founded 450 years ago, the city that today we face was basically built in the 20th century. Today, a little more than 100 years later, the greater São Paulo metropolis has more than 20 million inhabitants. This increase of population corresponded to a growth of times 70. São Paulo, which was a small city in the first four centuries of Brazilian history, became the main economical and cultural center of Brazil during the 20th century. That image, satellite image of São Paulo, shows in the east-west axis the city is about 60 kilometers long, and the north-south about 50 kilometers long. And what I would like to show you here is the, because it's related to what we are going to talk next, is the two main rivers. This is Tietê River, and this is Pinheiros River. As a result of this brutal development and of the related radical transformations, the city today has almost no buildings from centuries previous to the 20th century. Although in the center of the city we can find many eclectic buildings, most of them important ones and urban references, like the old railway stations, the central areas of São Paulo are constituted and characterized by large groups of modern buildings, built mainly in the 40s to the 70s. Here I can see Copan. This is Praça da República, a very important spot in the city. And large infrastructures. A second characteristic relevant to the contextualization of Jardim Edite is that São Paulo lies within a hydrographic basin on a plateau delineated by a network of water courses flowing through a hilly terrain. The metropolis is directly related to the trunk of the waterway system in the catchment basin that is formed by Rio Tietê and Pinheiros, which determines a constellation of discontinuous sectors. The railway system, established from the second half of the 20th century as an important link between São Paulo and the Port of Santos for the transport of coffee beans, in searching for available, flat, and cheap land, chose mostly trajectories parallel to the main rivers, Tietê and Pinheiros, starting the irreversible process of building the wetlands as an habitable space. So the yellow lines is the railway, and here Tietê and Pinheiros. It was quite a disastrous way of beginning the occupation of the city, the wetlands, but it was a plan. The railway, the industries, and so on. That image is the railway passing through. And the river was still in its natural way here. At the beginning of the 20th century, with mostly foreign investments, several interventions were carried out along the axis of São Paulo's valleys, aiming to generate and distribute energy for the city. The canalization of the rivers and draining of the wetlands opened up new fields of opportunities for real estate investments. That image is Rio Pinheiros, because it is a flat, is very flat land. The river goes farther in big curves, and now is showing already the canal marked where is going to be the future canal. The highways established from the 40s displace the axis of industrial concentration to their own adjacent areas outside of São Paulo. However, since almost all the highways converge and connect based on the expressways parallel to the Tietê and Pinheiros rivers, the strategic value of the wetlands was thus preserved. These expressways continue being, until today, the route of outflow of production of the entire state of the mandatory passage for the flow of cargo and passengers to and from the metropolis. So this is a pretty recent photograph. The materialized investment attracted the service sector in search of the now vacant, leave vacant by the industries, and cheaper areas with greater accessibility. As such, advanced service, the headquarters of multinationals, the wholesale sector, and entertainment and leisure industry established themselves mainly in the wetlands where they remain until today. This photo shows the banks of Pinheiros, and this area is very close where Jardim Edite is placed. And so we finally arrived at the location of Jardim Edite, indicated by the red dot at the point where the Águas Espraiadas River flows into the Pinheiros. The area shaded in blue indicated the limits of the Águas Espraiadas Basin. The public sector, not being foreign to the development of this region, has been an active agent in the building of infrastructure, investing large amounts in this particular area. The axis of the Águas Espraiadas River, being part of an important connection within the city, underwent a process we call urban operation. This is an important airport in São Paulo that's in the middle of the city. And this ring connects the airport to all this area in Rio Pinheiros and also a Morumbi crossing the river, a Morumbi that is a more residential area, but that at this time was developing. An urban operation is a legal instrument that, through the selling of constructive potential, allows the participation of private investment in the urban improvement of a certain area. When the Águas Espraiadas urban operation was initiated, there were 68 favelas along the river, among them Jardim Edite. The dots are the favelas. The wetlands of Águas Espraiadas, being partially public lands left vacant because of a change in the planning of a ring road system for São Paulo, drew the settlement of favelas on the banks of the river. The architect Mariana Fix published an important book whose title we can translate as Partners of Exclusion. That was her undergraduate thesis. It is a field study of the conflicted process of negotiation between the population and the infrastructure being built. The partners the title refers to are the private and public agents. Mariana Fix was in the favela following the process of people being taking off the favelas so the infrastructure could be built, or even with the land getting much more valuable. So it's a very confident book. I don't know if the English translation is right enough, but in Portuguese is very, very strong. Parceiros da Exclusão, meaning Partners of Exclusion. And this is the paradigma of the technicals treat the wetlands of the rivers, you see, because there is just a technique they wanted to sort out a technical condition, and there was not a plan thinking of the urban quality of the area. So there on the top they say congratulations because they had that and now they have that. It's a pretty disastrous, but it's a difficult question because in another hand you can't have that. It's dangerous, it's in the wetlands. So it's a very delicate negotiation. When we started the Jardim Edite project in 2009, the bridge that became one of the postcards of São Paulo was being inaugurated in the middle of the ongoing negotiations, because the private sector then buy the license to build more, and this money is applied again in the area. But the question is, what is more urgent? So they built this huge bridge and with this emphasis, but the favela was just next to the bridge. So when we started the project, the favela was like that, and there was this graffiti. So this one, fewer bridges and more housing for the people. The other one, less corruption and more housing. The favela. Initially, the site on which the future housing complex was to be built was bigger, with the provision of 500 units. During the process, the guidelines changed a few times according to the negotiations the municipality was still leading with the population of the favela and the middle-class residents of the neighborhood, because there was also this Asian there. The middle-class people living in the same block didn't want the housing, the social housing complex next to their houses. So it's pretty complex. The municipality was dealing with that as well. And the whole project was intermediated by the municipality, because there was this judicial question with the community and so on. Finally, the project was built on a smaller site with 252 units. For us, the main challenge was to successfully integrate the housing complex within a context of high investment and office developments. This photo was taken from one of the buildings, the window of one of the buildings that was under construction of Jardim Edite. We therefore consider it essential that the urban ground level should be public use. To achieve this, the ground floor plan of Jardim Edite was designated for public service such as a nursery, health service, and a restaurant school, which additionally met demands made by the population. We were very much involved in the viabilization of mixed use, which, although is not a novelty, became possible in the context of social housing in São Paulo, thanks to the effort and political will of Elizabeth França, who led the housing department during the Kassab mayoralty, and who fought to facilitate the coordination between the different departments of the municipality responsible for each of the services. Because the municipality is one, but there are different departments, each one with different budgets and different politics, and trying to find different space to put their equipments and different space to put the housing, as like they don't talk with each other. So it's not an easy articulation. This photo is the nursery internal garden. By having public service on the ground floor, the responsibility for the maintenance of the urban floor is given back to the public sector. In São Paulo, the person that lives is responsible for the pavement in front of their house. So sometimes, or normally, for this population, it's hard to maintain the quality of the ground floor plan, because it's expensive. And so when the equipments are in contact of the urban plan, you give back to them this responsibility. I think is a good strategy. The restaurant school is now in process of occupation and soon will be functioning. It's a program that is for the formation of professionals related with chefs or waitress or barmen. This photo is the central reception area of the health center that is also used as a meeting point for the whole community. That's the ground floor plan. So Jardim Edith is organizing two blocks. And the first block, we have two buildings of 17 floors with elevators and one linear building. Afterwards, we are going to see better that runs here, connecting both. And here, the restaurant school, a garden that separates both, and then the health center. In the second block, one of more 17 floor tower, another linear of 50 floor here, and the nursery. In social housing, those areas, legislation in São Paulo demands that certain areas surrounding a construction on a site be left empty, like 5 meters in the front, 3 meters in each side of the building. In social housing, those areas usually remain unused and consequently unmaintained. The unfenced limits of Jardim Edith avoid this problem by incorporating these areas into the now improved public space. So that's one of the buildings of 17 floor buildings that open, the open door is directly related with the city, and what should be the 5 meters in front is now incorporated of the public space. That's the entrance of the 5 floor building. This is also one thing that I think was important, because even if you have the sobreposition of use, one thing that I think is very important is to be very well characterized the address of each building, to not have a, so each building has a very characterized address. The area above the service building is designated as collective use. In each block, every residential building has shared access to this space. That's a transversal section of block one. So we are talking about this level. This is a common area. The 7th floor building, the 5th floor building here. Transversal cross section of block two. And that's during the process of handing over the apartments, the municipality made a huge mistake, we think, by considering each building as a separate entity, harming the principle of shared use. And also, what happened? When they considered each building as a separate entity, they closed the doors that connect the building with that common level. So today, the only building that has access to this local is this 5-floor building. The two other ones, they have a locked door. So no access, because it started a big conversation about, I have a lift, you don't have a lift, you can't use my lift because you don't pay for that. And I think the municipality, when they say that each one is each, they made a huge, enormous mistake, because it was the beginning. It started wrongly. Residential floor plan. Longitudinal cross section over the two blocks.
Thank you.
the plan of the five-floor buildings. The units must be at most 50 square meters because of the rules of the social housing financing system. Well, talking about the unit, we also always have the cross ventilation because we face two sides always. And also there is this possibility of closing a small bedroom here for a grandmother, for instance, or a small office. Or you can open everything your children grown up. So it's a flexible typology. By law, a building with more than four floors requires an elevator. In the case of Jardim Edith, to increase the supply of units without having to install an elevator, we occupy the top floor with duplex units. And also, there are some space, also in that building of five floor, in the other one of the 17th floor, that's a kind of prolongation of the house, like a small courtyard, that communicates, for instance, because when they give the units, they try to put together people from the same family, or they can choose where to go. So they articulate among themselves. And so this is those spaces working like a Christmas party. They open the doors and goes outside as well. That's an occupied unit. I like very much this photo because it's impressive the way that is caprichado. How to say that?
Carefully
done, because she painted the space in the same color of the walls. It's true, because it's very carefully done. It's with, in Portuguese we say caprichadas. The floor plan of its seventh floor building with four units and two different typologies. One typology here, and the other one in the middle. The landing shared by four apartments on each floor, built beyond the minimum legal requirement, works as an extension of the home, like a front yard. This really works like that because people do birthday parties. The unit is very small, the families are very big. So when they have this kind of birthday party, the party work is here, is in this space, is an extension of the house. The unit as it is delivered, so the municipality deliver as that the unit. And thank you very much.
Well, thank you, Martha. It was a wonderful presentation that gives us a little bit of perspective of
how. Okay. Hello. Yes. So I think it was a wonderful presentation. I want to thank you. It gave a little bit of a perspective about the city and about the scale of the challenges of the city. And it's such a wonderful project. And it immediately reminds me about the past 2 day reviews here at GSEP of the housing studios. And one of the questions, I mean, although these studios are not about social housing, I mean, they are focused in an area in the Bronx, one of the questions that many of the students were exploring was the question of shared spaces. And one of the main topics that came out in the reviews were about the ground floor and how the ground floor is occupied. In your presentation, I mean, I think you talked about both things. You mentioned your strategy to accomplish not only the usage of the ground floor to guarantee this and the recognition, the visual recognition of what is what, as well even the maintenance of how these things how those things can happen. And when you talk specifically about the corridor, and I was looking when she was presenting, and there was one of the drawings, one of the floor plans, that there was a bike, and I was thinking, yes, when I visited the building with Martha, actually, I mean, the picture you showed, there were no bikes, but actually people used the place to store their bikes. I was really thinking about, this is shared space, right? This is what we can say, this is an extension of home, this is that, somehow this is also an urban space in the way that it has the role of also the sidewalks when you can just open your door and sit there and talk to the neighbors. So I think this is really wonderful. But I want to ask you something, and how did it happen along the project? I mean, there is a lot of skepticism. There's a lot of skepticism in Brazil when talking about going vertical in social housing. And I know that this was a long process of negotiation with the people who were living there, with the, I imagine, the social movements, the leaders, the municipality. And how was this negotiated? How was this perceived? Which actions did you take in the project, imagine the future? I mean, how those things would happen?
Well, relating to the verticalization, when we, well, the municipality had a difficulty to think in verticalizate. But in that place, it's not possible to think in not verticalizate or take the most advantage of the land, because it's not because the value, it's because the urban value, because there are transportation, there are services, there are jobs. It's a very important area for people to be. That's why we did these two offers. There was one building that elevator, vertical and with elevator, so the maintenance is a little bit more expensive, so it's for a certain families, and there are other one that is not so expensive because there is no elevator. So I think should be more even. Renato was talking with me. He's not here. Ah, yes. He was just talking about the vertical buildings and how. So maybe you can say afterwards. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Around here and so on. I don't know. I think it's fine. And what happens is that this land that you give for sharing of four apartments, it works because the mother can be in the kitchen cooking and the small child is just there. So I think it's a concession that the situation of the verticalization and so on. But there is another the thing that I would like to comment, that is the common level on top of the equipment. Because that is an area that today, I think, is questionable. Well, we thought that could work very well being a very much infrastructured site, so you have these big avenues and so on. And because the ground floor is almost all occupied by equipments, we thought that area would be important. But maybe, I think what would be much better if the city could make this papel, the city role, squares. There is a square just next door to the nursery. The city could offer this kind of shared space, I think. Because when you create this shared space inside the housing, again, is an area that can need maintenance. And I think this population is very hard for them to have the maintenance of the areas like that. And also the house is such an urgent need that you make your house as better as possible. And you know, so today I think that, I don't know, maybe in the future they can manage to have a management that open the doors and really turns to be a shared area. Also in Jardim Edith, there is another situation that's almost impossible to deal, that is with the drugs that are there, because Jardim Edith is not a favela anymore, but the demand of the drugs users are just there. So it's a big spot. And for them, they want to have the control. They don't want to have the circulation going through everywhere. They want to have a door that they control who comes in and who comes out. So it's pretty difficult to make, also in that sense. I don't know.
So perhaps it's also a matter of scale, right? I mean, public space, the scale of what is public for to how many people it serves. So
yes.
There is a certain point that it becomes harder and it should go outside and
yes.
Really be...
Yes, it's in the city, it's for everybody. I don't know.
Yes,
that's a question I made myself after seeing what's going on there.
I think we're going to have questions in the end, right?
Yeah.
Okay,
questions.
Yes, sorry. Okay. And then, I mean, this comment about drug dealing and how they, I mean, they try to control space in there. And I mean, this is something which happened when the favela was there. Of course, the favela is excluded, but it's also self-excluded. But now not by all this population, but by the sectors, for example, that they want to keep it some kind of border, some kind of limits. So this brings this question. I mean, they are the same people and they moved from one place to the other. So I mean, the population is the same. Even the drug dealers, they also moved. And I wonder, how was this process? Because I imagine, I mean, there was a decision to tear down the favela, which I mean happened at some point of the urban operation. They said, okay, I'm gonna tear it down. And I imagine that there was a lot of pressure from the inhabitants or social movements to keep them there. But once this is established, how was that process? How was this process of design? Did the leaders or the inhabitants associations, they participate on the projects? How was this process?
Yes, yes, they participated, but in the case of Jardim Edith, because just one thing, on the Águas Espraiadas River, there are several other housing under construction and another ones just in project, but there are other ones. The conversation of the community was always, in the case of Jardim Edith, intermediated by the municipality, because unfortunately there was, for us, there was a judicial action going on, because the population was in judicial terms with the municipality, because the value of the land in the favela, what they were going to receive. Because, you know, that's difficult as well, because they are going to receive a 50 square meters apartment. Some of them lived in the favela in big houses. Is okay, there was no sun, there was problems with floods, there was questions, But sometimes the precariedade, the precariousness, allows situations that at first moment is more valuable because there were the main leadership. I went up several times at his house, and it was like that. You went to one room, to the other room, to the other room, to the other room. So it was a big house. So yes, we had the conversation, but there was always that going on until today. The municipality is finishing another block in front that they made the project inside the municipality, and there was no mixed use. So the ground floor is all fenced. So I don't know. And the community was asking for a complementation of the health service over there, but it's still going on, all the negotiation. I don't know, sometimes I think that a main role of the architect also is to participation of this process of conciliation in the end, because it's so many agents. You can't say, for instance, that the private sector is an enemy. No, should be one part of the whole, yes. So.
Yeah, so the architect, I mean, in this case, is an agent, right? And we were having this conversation about advocacy. So somehow, I mean, identifying potential other usages, for example, the nursery, the restaurant school, talking to the different, you mentioned that there was no conversation between the different departments of the city, so you had to go after them and somehow bring, as an external agent also, I mean, you're not from inside, so at some point you have a certain kind of neutrality that allows you to set the table and say, guys, I mean, you are not competing with them.
As long as the agents are in the same page.
In the same...
Yes. I mean, because that was important. Elizabeth França was inside the municipality, so
yeah.
She was able, we really much fight for that, and she was able to do it, because she was inside there. So every agent, and also you can't say that the private sector is an enemy, it's absurd, because it is there as well. So
just to finish, right? I think we're on time. Just one question. I mean, what lessons do you think you learned from this project, and what lessons do you think this project leads to think about social housing in the city, in dense city?
Well, I learned that we were involved also in another project that is Paraisópolis, and I learned that the participative process is fundamental. You can't do anything without listening all the parts, and it's not easy, because it's very complex. It's not like the bad guys and the good guys and that's it. So it's clear where to. I think it's complicated. It's question of try to conciliate all the parts. And sometimes it's not so easy to see the real problem, the real question that is involved. And I think more and more that for the projects, when you are able to formulate the right problem, you are fine. I think it's more the question of which is the real question and the real problem.
Okay, I think that's it. Thanks a lot, Marta.
Thank you.
No.
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Pedro and Marta. Cape Town and São Paulo are not necessarily the most obvious paired cities, but I think that what Pedro and I felt quite strongly at some of the earlier conversations about architecture practice and the city was to really sort of think about practices that are tackling difficult challenges of inequality in our various environments. And because the socioeconomic realities in South Africa and Brazil are so similar, we were thinking much more at the scale of building rather than at the scale of cities. So even though São Paulo and Cape Town are two very, very different topographies and population densities, the reality of they're both grappling with post-colonial realities, they're both grappling with issues of neoliberalism, and also market-driven real estate development in their respective cities. So I have the pleasure of welcoming and introducing Wolf Architects, which is a husband and wife team from Cape Town, and also very long-time friends of mine from South Africa. Wolf Architects is a design studio based in Cape Town, directed by Ilse Wolf and Heinrich Wolf. Heinrich has 20 years experience as a project architect and project manager, and has won several international awards, including the Daimler Chrysler Award for Architecture in 2007, the Lübeck 10 Award in 2005, and in 2011 he was elected the Designer of the Future by the Voter McMack Foundation. He's held several academic appointments internationally, including being a visiting professor at Etihad in Zurich from 2014 to 2015, IUAV in Venice in 2013, as well as an associate as an adjunct associate professor at the University of Cape Town in South Africa. The other half of this dynamic duo is Ilse Wolf, who is a partner of Wolf and graduated with a Bachelor of Architecture from the University of Cape Town. In addition to that, she also received an INFIL in Heritage and Public Culture in the African Studies Unit at the University of Cape Town. Ilse co-founded Open House Architecture in 2007, a transdisciplinary research practice which she continues to direct parallel to Wolf Architects. Both the principals of Wolf have taught and lectured internationally, including Switzerland, Germany, the United States, Canada, Japan, and India, and they continue to do so. And who knows, maybe sometime in the future also at GSAP. the work of the practice has also been included in various international exhibitions and biennale, including the Shenzhen Biennale, the Venice Architecture Biennale, the Louisiana Museum of Modern Art, and the Chicago Architectural Biennale last year, and also the São Paulo Biennale and the South American Architecture Biennale. So I know that Ilse and Heinrich would like to introduce their practice, so I don't want to take up too much space and time, so that we can just get a sense of the breadth of their engagement with architectural practice, from heritage to research to producing new and interesting and challenging typologies for dealing with spatial form. So please join me in welcoming them.
Hi, good afternoon. It's a pleasure to be here for both of us, seeing that we found each other in the city after losing each other about half an hour. The city turns out to be very big. thank you very much for the invitation, Paul, and everybody from Studio X and GSAP. It's a real honor to be here. We're always intrigued to see how much institutions like this are interested in the real gritty issues of environments like South Africa. So we want to talk about the production of the city, both the historic production of the city and our contemporary participation in the production of the city. And our motivation is a very simple and basic one, is that South Africa, unfortunately, is famous for inventing apartheid. Well, we learned a lot from the US, but this as a system of racist segregation, used the city as the primary instrument of division. And 22 years after the end of apartheid, that instrument still exists with a beating heart, exercising the power over its society that it had during the middle of apartheid. So it's an embarrassment and a problem to us. So we actively try and understand how this came about and how to antagonize such a massive construction. The other one is that whatever you say of inequality in Brazil, South Africa, unfortunately, is the most unequal society on earth. It's far more unequal than Brazil, unfortunately. So this is a very painful reality of how our society is constructed. And of course, the city is not an innocent participant in that. And our postulation is that as much as the economy constructs the city, the city constructs the economy. And we would like to talk today about how such constructs are come about and how they are antagonized.
Thank you. So our interest in Cape Town also is along the historical engagement with sites and with cities, and forced removals, histories of labor, the racialization of the city, and the effect on the social imagination haunts our thinking around the city of Cape Town and the way it has been produced. This year, we were very lucky to work with one of Cape Town's most interesting and up-and-coming artists, Kemang Waleoleri, in producing an intervention in the city that talks about how historical events and historical practices have been lost and how one can, in some way through heritage and through an art practice, can begin to intervene in a way that pays homage to a practice, for instance, like going to the cinema. We discovered through our research that there was an old cinema that existed in Boerkaap, which is the neighborhood where our practice is situated. And in 1984, this cinema was demolished to make way for a generic office block, which is situated there. But the cinema used to be a final refuge for city inhabitants that used to that were forcibly removed from the inner city of Cape Town, and was a kind of a last place for people to linger in a city that they were no longer welcome in. The Alibama cinema was demolished, but what we discovered was that the film that was playing minutes before the bulldozers came in was stopped and interrupted. It was a very typical 1970s flick starring Sophia Loren, and they actually interrupted the film and made people get out of the cinema. And then the bulldozers came in. And what we did was, in order to pay homage to this moment and to reflect on the social imagination, is to replay the film to the full extent on the site where the old Alibama cinema used to be. And in that way, create some kind of a public culture around that cinema and to reflect on the memory of that space. People came on the evening of the 7th of April, and essentially it was just a kind of a way to remember that space and pay homage. And the idea was that we would play the film, exhibit some of the newspaper clippings inside the corner shop, and also produce a pamphlet, a little publication where we would exchange ideas and letters around the history of this place. Another project that we are currently involved in with Wale Uleri is the memory of Luyolo, which was a township outside of Simonstown, on the very sort of touristy side of Cape Town. Luyolo was a neighborhood that was designated for a whole range of people that were brought in to establish the infrastructure of Cape Town. Many people from West Africa were housed there, indigenous people, and essentially it was a black neighborhood that was completely erased in 1965, and today it is a beautiful sort of paradise kind of a neighborhood where we one really don't have any trace or sense that this neighborhood even existed. So what we are trying to do is to recollect, pay homage to Luyolo by, again, writing letters to people that perhaps lived there. There's an exchange of letters between Kemang and I. Kemang's interest is in the fact that he is from Guguletu, where most of the people from Loyola were then removed to. So in a sense, our interest as architects is to think about the kind of unequal relationship between black labor and white capital and the kind of infrastructure that emerged out of that unequal relationship. So these people that lived there were responsible for the building of major infrastructure in Cape Town, the railway lines, the harbors, and roads in Cape Town. And in our way, in our thinking around heritage is just to remember and be conscious of that. Heinrich will talk about another kind of research practice that also fills our engagement with the city and in terms of fills our consciousness when we design and we're trying to make shifts in how Cape Town has been produced.
This research project is a project really into the spatialization of the economy with the aim of saying, well, if one wants to make the city more penetrable for poorer people, one must study the economic practices in the context of poverty and economic practices in their spatialization. So without going to any depth of anything that we studied a whole series of rental apartments that's self-built by people without any financing. But fundamentally, the lesson that came out of this is that in the context of great opportunity in urban areas, people make very, very small parcels of land. The average apartment size is 8 square meters, and the rental per square meter is similar to penthouses in the center of the city. So it means that people turn land that appears to be marginal into very valuable land by parceling it in small pockets. We looked at daycare centers, and the issue at interest here, the conclusion that we came out, is this issue of threshold to entry. So this is in the context of subsidized government housing, but the women who run these daycare centers, if they have a subsidized house, have a zero threshold to enter into an economy and into an economic practice. And this interests us. Is what? How can we lower the threshold to entry into the economy? Then we studied infrastructural things, like this neighborhood has a whole lot of cul-de-sacs in it, dead-end streets, and we studied how several economic practices happen, but significantly motor car repair, and how a piece of infrastructure that with no imagination of this economic activity has, in many, many of these cul-de-sacs, you find this motor car repair activity that's happening. So this idea that generic infrastructure can support very specific economic activity and that we have to set up these opportunities as designers. And then the last lesson, this is a very typical taxi interchange, but what we are interested in here is economic interrelationships. So take the taxi stop. It's funny, there's a building that's not used. All the taxis stop outside of the building. It's designed for that purpose. And then there's a series of shops around it. But these shops can't exist if it were not for this activity. This is one of these shops, and we are interested in these activities that then exist next to it. So the taxi business being the primary business, these shops being a secondary business, and these sort of car repair and motor wash and all sorts of other businesses being tertiary businesses. So the fact that opportunity is stratified and that there are minor businesses that can only exist because of the major businesses, but that's a spatial setup that architects can participate in.
So just to move closer to the site where the watershed was developed, this is a historical map of the V&A waterfront. And in terms of how we engage with our historical consciousness and also our research around how the city is produced around spatial economies through the research in Dunoon and taxi ranks, we thought that this can all feed into a very dynamic way of thinking about the waterfront, which is, in effect, is the most explicit kind of site for this production of the unequal relationship between black labor and white capital in terms of the waterfront was the first site in a way where you'd find a labor compound that was completely racialized in that location there. And our site is located just north of that. And also there's a jail that was established essentially for convict labor. Convict labor was established to build this kind of infrastructure. So this is another image from 1905 where you can see that location, the labor compound over there, and our intervention would be situated right over there. So we were conscious of this calcifying effect that continues to have on the contemporary city of Cape Town, and our design of the watershed is trying to just think about and be conscious of this very big sort of retail environment that is sort of produced around this historical effect, and trying to make a shift and make it more porous for small-scale economies and marginalized economies and marginalized people. This is an image of Cape Town, a historical image of Cape Town, where what you don't see is that the kind of, this is our... This is the harbor, the V&A harbor, and this is the big piece of reclaimed land in the foreshore development. And this whole section on this side has been cleared as part of a sort of forced removal and racialization of Cape Town. This is District 6, so this part of Cape Town does not exist anymore. And essentially, that is the kind of setting that we needed to be conscious of when we try to make an intervention that could possibly open up the city to economies.
Yeah, I think it's significant to know is that the event that preceded the making of the waterfront is declaring the city white, removing non-white people entirely from the city, and then suddenly a property is developed and it's hugely successful. One could claim that those things are independent of each other, but of course they are not. So what we want to show is this was the building before we got involved. It's next to a dry dock. It's a very successful aquarium that gets 400,000 visitors a year, and there's 400,000 people a year and 25 million people a year come here. This area here receives more visitors than any other site in Africa. More people than the pyramids in a year, so it's the most popular tourist site in the continent. So we were approached to, in the front part of the shed, to build a business incubator. The shed had fairly conventional interior with crane rails and a wooden floor, and we were asked to make an interior project of this and occupy this space and make a business incubator. Now, for those of you who don't know, business incubators are things that set up to stimulate new small businesses, individuals coming into it, with the ideas that with institutional support, the businesses are more likely to take hold, succeed, and be successful. There's statistics that prove this. So this, of course, is the agenda of our client. We never pretend to have the same agenda as our client because we don't run business incubators. We run an architectural studio. We are concerned about the city. So the question is, what's the architectural corollary of a business incubator? So we were saying to ourselves, if we are asked to make a building that can stimulate business, what would be the architectural and urban counterform of such an idea? The yellow area was the area that we were given. There was an existing market in there. Pedestrians had to move around this building between this very popular aquarium and shopping center on that side. So it's a very busy area, but this building being a complete congestion to that area. So then we thought this project that we were asked to do is not a good one because we can't do it well. We do not believe that design can save projects, because there's no amount of design that can dig you out of a bad hole. You've got to get into another position in order to make a good design. So what we did, And because we were concerned about the logic of this whole project, as to whether we can do a good job, Eels and I decided to risk the whole job and not do what they asked us at all, to design another building and to propose a completely different thing. So instead of making this business incubator as an interior job, we decided to make it an exterior. Instead of making it inside, we made it an outside. And instead of making it a building, we made it a piece of city. So what we did is we proposed that we amalgamate functions in the building and build a road right through the building, and then float the business incubator above it and use the business incubator to create economic opportunities in red below it. So in other words, this thing that it proposes that it can do to stimulate business, that it does it in the city. Because the fundamental proposal is here is that an unequal city is produced by the upper classes and by the wealthy and by the powerful. It's not produced by the poor. The poor are not the agents of inequality. So the idea is that if the actions of the powerful and the wealthy can be adjusted, there's something about how they act in the city that could be more responsible and more porous to economic opportunity. So you can see this is the building within this network, and so this is the network that we try to support. Some of this network, of course, pre-existed, but it's particularly this line through here and the connections higher up that we try to support. So this, in essence, is the ground floor plan. It makes a very basic route through it, the simplest architectural move you can have. It's a really straight, very legible line. And then makes many, many pockets of very small space, 4 square meters. I'll show you now even 2 square meter spaces, retail spaces, and many, many of them. So the idea is that one uses this intense foot traffic that this big commercial property has and begin to make this an opportunity for many. And then to make things like a big hall for exhibitions that draw people into it. And you can see it's not a dead end, it's a continuation and so on. We are very concerned in the structure of the city with impermeability and discontinuities. Discontinuities is the fundamental production of segregation. So in South Africa, the urban plans of Lewis Mumford were racialized, and then you just make buffer zones, which we learned from you guys, and you get very, very durable segregations that last for decades. So this idea of not making segregated spaces and having these continuations through this is important. This is the first floor plan, what you would call the second floor, huh? Which is where the business incubator is. And this has a series of mezzanine levels that look out. This is a big flying floor, a 50 by 50 meter steel structure with huge holes cut into it where you can see down into the market, but with a fundamental feature is that having a cafe right in the center. So its boardrooms is a social space, and the idea is that everybody looks down into the social space, and that fundamental growth of the organization happens through meeting of strangers and new interaction, and that happens through social interaction rather than necessarily through work. This is the section. You can see the market down here, the big dry dock on this side. This is the suspended floor. It literally is hung off the crane rails. So column-free space made here. You can see a mezzanine up there, and the idea is that it overlooks this space so that everybody can see each other. It constructs a kind of institutional intimidation. And it can look down onto the market so that there's a reciprocity between traders and established business and new business, because each can teach each other something else. And then this big exhibition hall that sits here that draws crowds through this, because our fundamental idea was, instead of making this business incubator, is to make, instead of making one building function, is make a series of urban functions. In other words, make a multiplicity of functions and increase human density and increase human the diversity of activity, so that people don't come to this place for one purpose alone, but they come for a variety of purposes. Then you can see there's the floor hanging. The floor hangs within this existing warehouse, and it doesn't touch the sides, and where it's short of the sides, there's a park-like space made in between, and a big stair that then overlooks this dry dock. This is the end of the building where it's a single barrel, and I'll speak a bit about these freestanding, they're like little shops and things built in underneath here. But this was basically made as a space for expansion for the business incubator. This is the ceiling plan where you see the underside of this big grid with the holes cut into it. Now, this is very important because this building started its life as a university who proposed this business incubator. Now, we live in a country where a representation is an absolute crisis. It's very hard to know what to refer to. History is corrupted. And the idea that in this building we will not produce an appearance, we will produce an effect. In other words, the business that it stimulates is what you will remember this thing by rather than what it looks like. So we produce an insubstantial appearance. And the most substantial part of this building, instead of being an elevation, is in fact a ceiling. And it's not, so it's not its own ceiling. It's not the ceiling that defines the business incubator. It's the underside of the floor below it that stimulates the business. And that is how we try to deflect what this architecture is about. So business incubator is up here. This market is down here. You want...
Sure. Yeah, this is the next two slides are very important because it shows our imagine and our aspiration for this space through architectural rendering, and we can talk a little bit later how those aspirations were met with our client or not, but essentially what we aspired that the space becomes an open space with a kind of a market that is for everyone that you can move in. There's a market in Cape Town called the Milnerton Market, and we learned a lot from that in terms of how it could really just be not a curated kind of a setup where there's a people that choose a lifestyle or kind of a lifestyle set, but it's really kind of a very open, democratic kind of a space.
This is the same unit shown at a different time, where we show what can be a market, could be a place for fashion shows, could be a place for selling Ferraris. Now you can say, how do Marxists make buildings for selling Ferraris? You know, we are interested not in the Ferraris, we're interested in the tertiary business that comes off somebody selling expensive cars or something. So there's this thing is that you can do something to draw a big crowd, and small business can make some money off the side of it. So this is the building when the suspended floor was finished and it was not occupied yet. I'll show you now what it looked like when it's occupied, but I want to draw your attention to the urbanity of this building, that this building really is much more of a city than it is a building. So this is, in a way, a building. We did very little to this building. So we inserted into it a hanging floor with big stairs on the side. On the side, we make two spaces for expansion with fire escapes, and this, of course, is permanent. But that's all that's permanent about it. So the most permanent thing in this building is actually the roof of the sewer. But then we made these little, this is all to the same scale, by the way. We made these little things, it's between furniture and buildings. And the reason why we made them like furniture is that they become trivialized in a way. Then we make smaller things that's much more like furniture and less like buildings, and things that's very much like furniture, but a little bit like a wall still. And then we made things that's entirely like a cupboard. And then we made a thing that's a little thing like that. Now, you can appreciate that if you lose this thing, the building is not affected by that. If you lose this thing, it's not affected. If you lose that one, you're not affected. If you paint it pink, blue, throw it away, it doesn't matter. And that is what we try to do. It's a building that stops making itself earlier on. In other words, its fabric does not matter. So I think in South Africa, we're fairly unique in that we make buildings where we don't care that much about the appearance. We care a great deal about its operation. And right when the building was done, I was teaching at ETH, and I got this angry phone call from the office saying, the people are painting the stuff pink and blue, and they're throwing them away. I said, fantastic, you know, we're in business. So that was the setting as it sits there next to the harbor, and you can see the street just running right through it. It's very difficult to see this building because it's very successful, so there's tons of people in it. But you can see there's this hanging floor that sits in this double barrel side of this warehouse. This is the side of it. You can see it's just hanging, and you see these big stairs going up there. This is again the side of it where you see some of the trees it's planted between the new hanging floor and the existing shed. We didn't do this part of the building. That's all as it was. And this is underneath this hanging floor, where you see the market. Now, here, these things are still fairly intact, but if you look at some of them, people painted them black, and if you go there today, they are very, very different, and people are adding doors to them and all sorts of crazy things, and it really doesn't matter. The fundamental thing is this floor that's gone through, and we haven't even made this because this is the factory floor as we found it. The important thing is the reciprocal relationship between this market and the business incubator up above. Here we are on the upper level before the cafe was fitted out, and you can see the market up here and the business incubator up there. There you can see the cafe sits right at the entrance, and the idea is that people sit and work here on these upper levels, view of the mountain and the harbour, but yet you can see what your colleagues are doing, what they're producing, and you can see who's meeting there. And if you're a junior in the organisation, you see a senior person there, you can run down and go and have a cup of tea with them, or you like them, you want to date them, you can do that. And that's the cafe that's then in the centre of this business incubator. And just in conclusion, you can see this is a 2 square metre tenancy. This person pays per square metre more than Louis Vuitton in the same space because the space is so valuable, and it's a really good deal because they make really good money. This is a 4 square metre tenancy where this woman is making some beadwork that she's selling right there, so she's producing and selling it right in the same space. It is not a very high price, you've got to pay for it because it's not a lot of space, but you get a few million people a year that walk past you.
Just to also add to that is that one needs to understand that the waterfront as a retail environment is extremely exclusive for business owners, particularly. We've just got H&M now. We're very excited about H&M being there. But that is a kind of big scale corporation that is in the waterfront. And for a building, for the waterfront to open itself up to possibilities of small scale retail is we found that it's something very progressive that we could push with our agenda as well in terms of opening up the economies to many people and to small-scale traders.
Maybe we should conclude, because we're running out of time. This is a plan, instead of the configuration of the building, just showing the activity. And what it just shows is an amassment of small businesses that could be craft people, could be people selling vegetables, could be people doing hairdressing and clothes fitting and those sorts of things. But the idea is that there's an amassment of this opportunity supported by bigger institutions around it that draw people to it and through it. And that in this kind of a way, we are adjusting the morphology of the city, which adjusts the morphology of the economy. And in this way, we're aiming to make the economy more permeable to small-scale business. And we've taken the same kind of a thing, and we've done it with office buildings where we make very, very small office space and so on. But with the idea is that the privileged part of town must be transformed in a way to allow this permeability. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Ilse and Heinrich, for just giving us a sense of the scale of your engagement with the city. I thought that the relationship between the research that you do in Cape Town and how it informs your design intervention and design thinking was really, really fascinating, especially with regards to microeconomies and microspaces and making the city more permeable. I was wondering though, you know, you've done this research in Dunoon, and also, let's just focus on the Dunoon example. And I was wondering what kinds of challenges you faced from shifting from looking at economies that are embedded in communities in the Cape Flats and shifting it into the waterfront. So, what do you think was gained? What do you think might have been lost in that kind of shift?
It's an interesting question. I would have to think long and hard whether I can give you the answer right now. Is that the thing for us is that the communality is a fundamental thing. And that is opportunity. So in the close to a big public transport hub or something like that, it's very often in South Africa that has a segregated view of the economy. They very often talk about the first economy and the second economy being
sort of unregulated, so-called informal, often thought of as illegal, non-taxpaying, et cetera, and then very often not properly theorized in economic terms or in spatial terms. There's something that people miss the fact that the only activator is opportunity. So you can go and do it anywhere in the city as long as you have opportunity, in a way. The problem is the owners of that opportunity, you know, is it the city, is it the property developer, or so on. And that is where the challenge lies, because of course those owners, if it's a public authority, they have certain kinds of agendas and so on, and people are worried about the effects of small-scale business and the management of small-scale business and so on. But within a democratic constitutional state, the care of small-scale business is, of course, a fundamental thing, because the growth of the economy lies in that location. So the challenges lie for us in that people do not have any conception of the nature of that economy, of how small space can be and how useful it can be and how economically productive it could be. So in this case, what we did is the person who worked with us from the developers largely kept people around him in the dark as to how this thing will work until he could declare the kind of money that was made. Because everybody likes the money that comes out of it. But the reality of a small-scale space was a difficult thing for people to get their heads around. That was a bit of a challenge. I don't know if that answers your question.
I think it does in part, and it kind of leads on to my next question, sorry, which has to do with your role as an architect, and how were you able to negotiate your relationship to the future imagined occupants of the building and your various clients, because you were dealing with a lot of competing impulses around this project. So how were you able to navigate those power relationships?
Well, I think we were not as successful as we would have hoped to be, because it's unfortunately the slide I skipped right in the end to speed up, but we had an idea of very ordinary city trade, like hairdressers and tailors and clothes sellers and all sorts of people there, because the question for me is not who is there, it's just whether they pay the rent or not. You know, as far as I'm concerned, if you pay the rent, you're okay. But the landlords intervened by appointing curators for the market, and then they sort of looked at, you know, the best kind of merchandise and so on, and made it a super attractor in that sense. So they added to the economic success of it. But I think that it, in our mind, still has the potential of being more ordinary, because I think spaces like this does not have to be extraordinary. They can be quite ordinary, and as long as you can pay the rent, you have high income generating spaces. That's good for the developers, but it's good for whatever tenant takes that space, you know. So we hope to make many more of these spaces in the city.
I just want to add to that, in that, you know, this project was extremely fast-paced. I mean, it was 18 months right from the beginning of the presenting the project until the completion of the project. And I think that was kind of to our advantage in a way, because at the same time this project was being imagined and implemented, it was really under the radar of the waterfront at large, because Thomas Heatherwick was doing his beautiful sort of building on the silo, and that was everybody's attention was more or less focused on the opening and the design of that project, and this one was very happily under the radar in a way, and we were successful in terms of trying to like push things that normally I think would have been much more focused and thought about and, you know, questioned a little bit more. And also I think the developer that we had on our team was really very interested in pushing some kind of a different retail environment, and for a long time this project was sort of left vacant because there wasn't an imagination that could propel it in a way to this kind of thing. So when we proposed this sort of kind of small scale economic idea, it was very happily accepted. But at the same time, when it came to when it became a focus in a way, other people came on board, curators, lifestyle enthusiasts, those kinds of people. So I would have been very, very nice if it was just under the radar the entire time. So we could have been a little bit more open in terms of, or we could have been given a little bit more freedom to choose or would be intervene into the kind of people that occupy it eventually.
I mean, that, I think that that also connects to a question of scale, right? Like, what can architects and architecture achieve in the city in order to be transformative? And I'm wondering, I mean, you know, the appearance of the lifestyle curator. I don't know if that's a person. If that, that's a job?
Yeah.
Okay. So there's the appearance of the lifestyle curator, which is sort of like a micromanagement of the aesthetics of your intervention. And then there's another scale, which is the real estate developer, which is like this privately owned, massive real estate. And somewhere in that is the architect. And I'm wondering what the points of friction were for you, and what do you think are the points of friction, but also the things that maybe needs to be tackled in a much more sort of aggressive or at a different scale, right? There's only so much that an individual building can achieve. So what kinds of shifts do you think would be necessary in order to test this prototype to make it sustainable or viable?
I can maybe first talk about the frictions and then about the successes. The frictions were immense in the beginning. You must appreciate we got a brief and a commission. People said to us, please, we need this building fast. We changed the site and the brief. So when we presented this in the first meeting, the client was red in her face. She wanted to murder us. It was very clear. She wanted to fire us immediately and get another architect who could be more obedient and go and do what they asked us for. So we had the argument that a flying structure would be cheaper. A flying structure in a bigger envelope with more actors would be cheaper than an interior job. And it really turned out to be factually correct simply because of common interest. We established common interest between the V&A, who was the property holder, and this business incubator that was a tenant, so to speak. And because common interest was behind it, everybody pushed to get the building. But it took the business incubator client much longer to understand the project than the commercial side. The commercial side, of course, being more practiced in developing buildings. I mean, it's a very plain reason, but the property developer was hugely supportive because basically we showed them the money. So we've learned, I mean, it's a very weird thing, but you know, we can peddle very aggressive social agendas if we show people the money. So somebody says, I want a 9% yield on this development. You show them the 9% and then you can go. It's like your ticket. It's your, you know, ticket to play. You know, if you can't make them the money, they don't want to participate. If it's commercial development, because there's a pension fund behind it, people who are appointed to make the pension grow, they're not going to do anything else. You're in cloud cuckoo land if you think you're going to propose an agenda that doesn't make money for them. And so we had to show them the money, and then the doors of heaven opened. So the success, in a way, is a curious one in that it's been hugely successful. It prints money, it is so successful. The client entered it for two awards, and we first giggled when we heard we sort of won the award. It's the Shopping Center of the Year award, and the property developers, it's like very coveted awards, the Shopping Center Innovation Award, Property Developers Retail Award, and so on. And we would never enter it for things like that. And then we thought, but we didn't think it was a shopping center. I mean, I did my thesis on how to destroy the typology of shopping centers. So what is interesting is it becomes influential in that other developers see it, they hear about the money that's being made, they look at how you make the money, say, wow, you didn't go to any of the big chain stores, you didn't speak to any of the successful entities, you just made small space. You know, so suddenly we show that it is not a sort of philanthropic heart that is required to let the poor into our cities. You can, there's a certain kind of a business practice that can maintain itself whilst transforming the city. And we think that is probably the biggest success of it.
Okay, thanks. I think we're very rapidly running out of time. So, and I'm sure that there are questions from the floor, so.
Yeah, should everyone?
Yes.
I have more questions, but I can ask. Yeah, I can ask it tonight.
I think that's actually really, one of the questions that we had, and there are a number of them. One had to do with scale, and I think that was the value of actually looking at both these projects, is the question of the architect's intent, but also while wrestling with all of these major issues around landscapes of inequality, the histories, municipalities, you've got private sector, but you also have the residents themselves. And one of the last questions that we had developed was, who are the agents of a particular project in the process of the design, particularly following the post-occupancy period? And I think both of you talked about, the ways in which the residents themselves, regardless of maybe what the client's intent was or the architect's intent was, transformed the intention of the architect in that regard. So I'm just wondering if you could both follow up on that, and then we can just open it out.
So in Jardim Edith, I think it's pretty active because, as I was saying before, the precarity sometimes allows certain relations that when you formalized is not acceptable anymore. That is very weird thing to say because it's not an apology of precarious, not at all. But the fact is that even the people that live there, they used to live in a certain way that afterwards it becomes like a conflict. They can't manage anymore because they could accept when they lived in favela to cross the backyard of their neighbors, but they can't accept anymore to share a common area like I was talking about. It's difficult to manage it. It's very weird. Sometimes it's hard to understand what is the process. I didn't answer your question, did I?
Let's try it.
I think for us it was very important to understand that the city is at the same time very calcified in terms of its sort of practice around retail and commercial development, and at the same time also very kinetic, so that, you have you, what we learned from our from the research in the noon, that there's a very sort of intense kinetic sort of ways of working and spatializing economies, and at the same time in a situation like the V&A waterfront, it's quite calcified, and it's a direct relationship out of the histories of long histories of unequal inequalities and so on. And I think that what we try to think about is that simultaneity of that kineticism and calcification. And I think housing is similar in a way, that it's not stable. And this idea that, these things are always kind of in flux. And what we try to do with the waterfront is try to make one kind of gesture that perhaps could then direct or mitigate this sort of simultaneity, which is the street, this market street, and moving through that. And I think for me, that is the interest in that project for me, is like, how does that street become the sort of very single or stable gesture for the economy and inequality? So I'll be very interested to see how I'm looking at the sort of future of that street in a way.
I think the formal device through which participation of people is ensured is not finishing the building. So there's something about this very pristine, well-considered, beautiful architectural artifact that is so superior to other artifacts made by ordinary people that is an antagonistic, aggressive thing. So there's something about making it incomplete and allowing a degree of its completion and its continual completion open to the residents, the tenants, in the case of our building.
Yeah, which is a housing project in terms of what you said about the units can be reconfigured. That's interesting.
Yes, and also I agree completely with that, and also the common areas suffer certain transformations. People start to, I hope they do in Jardim Edith, because it's very recent, the occupation there. So I hope that with time also they can make it much more active, the influence.
And for sure, I mean, the idea of the future of the building, the post-occupancy, and how does it happen, and how it doesn't becomes like some individual's initiative, but becomes more like a collective agreement, is pretty much related on how things are conceived in the terms of how people were engaged in the process. Because when people are engaged in the process and they feel part of the process, they recognize each other. They recognize their decision. So this is their decision. And this, for sure, has a huge impact on how the building develops in the future.
Yeah, because I feel like both of those projects are very intent on how they design their socio-spatial ecologies because of how you've studied the transformation of the city. And it's just very clear in terms of like how, you know, the occupants, the residents, then have agency within that space to transform over time, which is very important.
Yes. Do you know there is a thing about also Jardim Edith, because that is hard to think. Because the place where it is, that's very valuable, there was a thing like that, well, everybody's going to sell their units and go away, because sometimes the urgency is so big. The people think, well, I can have some money now, so sell it. It's what people said. Well, it's going to be sold and this population go away. And in fact, that didn't happen, because the recognition of the process of the battle to keep being there, and also the recognition of being in this place of the city, again, not because it's rich, no, but because it's very much configured city. There is transport, there is jobs, there is the square, is a nice place to live. So people didn't sell. That's a good thing, I think.
So questions from the audience?
Yes. So what point are you going to? So one point I wanted to bring to the discussion is about Jardim Edith, how after the building was handed to the municipality and how they broke your plan of the ground floor by putting the doors and fences and whatever. It's more about how in the project still could integrate like this this post dysfunction of the municipal system or the public service that is going to be in charge of the space, and how to make sure that these strategies that like what you projected was a shared ground space will survive despite or will function or will happen in spite of a dysfunctioning public system. I don't know, it's not so much a question, but more like a reflection on how to integrate like in the project and in the design the other factors that go beyond, no? after it. I don't know if I'm clear.
How to integrate?
Yeah, and what lessons maybe from Jardim Edith?
Well, in Jardim Edith, actually, it's not in the ground floor that was broke. I think the ground floor works very successfully in terms of conveyance and everything. Was the top of it when the common area on roof of the equipment. That I ask myself if it's really interesting to make a space like that, or as I said, I think the city should make this role, the city in itself. But I think one of the things that is the participative process that in Jardim Edite was big, but was very conflictive. I think that was a problem. I mean, it's a historical process that is good that to be like that because guarantee the existence of this housing there. But the conflict sometimes is prejudice, is é um prejuízo. If you can get a degree of, and there is not cuckoo land like you said, but if you can get a degree of consents, it's possible because, as you said as well, if people that the private sector is getting money from it, that's possible. I don't think that it is. It's not bad. They can get money. Great to make a thing that is good for everybody. Great. So, I think that's the main question.
First, I really appreciate this initiative to put together Brazil and Africa, because we are all, I'm Brazilian, professor, we are all condemned to be Latin American, and sometimes it split us from part of our past and the huge presence of African culture in Brazil due to Portuguese empire and colonization. So it's very interesting, and I think that the South African cities, big cities, has so much things in common with Brazilian metropolis that we should do that often, not to have to came to U.S. to meet us. It's a remarkable point. We have to be more in contact. But as we are all content to be more integrated with the close neighbors, that is good, it's not bad, but we have this part of us that is separate from us. So this is one point. The second point is how to think the public spaces in the housing and in renovations like that you propose. One, I'm living here since August in Harlem. I'm visiting professor of the Department of Art History. And at Harlem, I'm changing my mind about these some remarkable statements, criticism on the projects. Because when I arrived in summer, the projects, the housing projects there, the towers, the space between them is very intensively occupied, used by people. And there's no difference from the traditional old public spaces of the streets in the neighborhood. So the old streets and the modernist space between the towers are both intensively used. So I think 50, 60 years later, we have to review Jenny Jacobs in the way how we think about the streets and this behaviorist approach to architecture and urban planning and urban design mainly. One thing that Marta, I never heard you saying that that public space, semi-public space above the facilities are a problem now. But this
is
not intensively used, but this is common. I visit often housing projects everywhere. It's a kind of hobby of mine. It's not my main research line. But in England, if you go to the all this, that movement of landscape urban design for the elevated catwalks, they are those places are impossible to go. It's you feel afraid to pass through an elevated catwalk in Thames Mead or any of those or buildings of the states. While the old Corbusian style estates are very well, quite well, because you have the buildings over stilts over a common space, and people are using it as well as neighbor traditional place. So I think this we have to review some statements that were conceived in the 60s in the criticism to modernism, and that mainly in this, because this what you did is elevate and free the ground for people and create facilities to intensively be used. It's so obvious, but why we don't do that?
That's not a question. Sorry. Not a question, just a comment.
Yeah, I can give you a quick response to that.
I actually think your observation is absolutely right, because I live near the grand houses down the street, public housing, and I don't think New York has ever torn down any of its public housing. I may be wrong about that. But unlike Chicago, St. Louis, and many of the other cities, the public housing survives, and I think it has everything to do with the history of social movements within public housing to maintain various social services, the fact that there's was always a high level of union organization, so people had jobs, which then, you know, fostered businesses that were locally owned. There was a kind of ecology around public housing that allowed it to sustain itself in this city in ways that other cities failed, precisely because the poor were always marginalized, they were often exploited, and then their contributions diminished. So they weren't actively engaged with the larger kind of ecologies that allowed life to be sustained in a way. And it's very different, and you sense it when you walk through public housing in New York, for sure, certainly at this moment.
I guess this question is more to Martha, but I'd also be interested in what Heinrich and Ilse have to say as well about how to preserve kind of the informal social organization in the favelas when you move into a vertical, more formalized space. Like, you have common spaces that you talked about, but how do you maintain kind of familial relations or kind of broader social kind of organization in these new spaces?
Como você mantém as estruturas sociais que você faz essa exposição?
Well, they, in terms, in the particular case of Jardim Edite, they were a community very much well articulated, because a long history of fight for to be there, as I showed. So this changing was not so big. They had their leaderships, or they have this organization of the community, and this organization keep being until today. Of course, when you put in a vertical condominium, the population were much more used to live horizontally, but it's like any vertical condominium. You have to start to learn how to up floor, down floor, and everything. But I think in the case of the Vietnamese, they keep being much, because they work already as a plate. What I was referring is that what's curious is that some kind of acceptance in the informal, had acceptance. It's not that people were conformed by that. No, they convive together much easily, I think, than in the formalization of a vertical building. So they start to fight for things that before they accept better. I don't know. But in the case of Jardim, there was this. There was not a big change in kind of the organization and everything. But there is a thing that I could just say, that also in São Paulo there is no rental, social rental.
Social housing
for rent. Yes. Once in a time is much easier for everybody, I think. Because the management is pretty hard in terms of maintenance. It's expensive, and sometimes it's not well maintained, and so on. So I don't know why it's not, but I think This is, I think, that's the new planetary tool, the
new master plan.
Master plan can change. Yeah, I think it's a very good way of thinking the housing for rent.
We've been involved in some housing projects as well, and I mean, Marta, you mentioned that people were given the right to choose who their neighbours across the stairway would be. And this thing of being able to choose your neighbours is a very fundamental thing in constructing a new community. Why that is such a useful device, not only because you can choose your neighbours and feel comfortable with those around you, is that very often in the context of social housing, the units are identical, precisely identical, for fairness in a way. So you have 1,000 people, 1,000 recipients, and 1,000 identical units. Architecturally, it's a very difficult thing to handle. But to make units in such a way, I mean, we do it very often much more horizontally, but so that people could, say, turn units to each other and turn it around. So you begin to get a diversity that comes out of the urban space, although the basic components are similar. And it's a very useful thing, both in the social reconstruction of the thing, but also in the architectural design of it, to give it life.
We have two more questions.
So. Right, so I really sort of wanted to go back to maybe an issue that has been sort of presented to both of you separately, and that's the sort of issue of the position that the architect can occupy through design in relation to the power and almost infinite, in terms of South Paulo, anyway, infinite vastness of the city and its administration, in a sense, and the ease with which I think that infinity can subvert some of the very close, intimate work that you might have been doing as you evolved and responded to a brief that you might have been given. I think in your case, Marta, the very idea that you probably went into negotiations or meetings with the community as you were developing the project, and then it sounds like you were very regretful that the units were sort of split apart, sort of high-rise ones with the middle ones, in terms of, if I understood you correctly, in terms of how they were subsequently managed. You're saying that they're sort of privatized, that the occupants own the spaces. Did I understand that correctly?
No. What happened is the two vertical buildings,
yeah,
they closed their doors.
Yeah.
Because there is a bridge, mm-hmm, of access, so this common level connected the three blocks, the three buildings. The two big ones closed their doors, so the only one that has an access is the smaller and lower one.
So, but there must have been a logic to their closing the doors.
The closing the door is because they pay, they say, we pay for our lift.
Okay.
So the other ones that has no lift, there is no right to come through out the door that connects it and use our lift.
Okay, but
that's a question. I don't think it's the question of the person that thinks that. The problem is that the municipality go there and say, that's one building, three buildings,
yeah,
separate ones.
So as you were developing the project, I presume you were in constant meetings, and did they buy that idea to start with, and then somehow post the project being completed, they separated? Because in a sense, I would presume that as you were developing the project, that's one of the things that they loved about the project in the first place.
Yes, but that's one question that we couldn't develop so closely with the community development, because there was a judicial condition between the community and the municipality.
Yeah.
They were fighting. So our relation with the community sometimes was informal, because they called the office and we discussed like that. but the municipality obeys any of relation we had with the community be through them. So it was not really, was strong because the community was well organized, so they managed to do. But unless there was a little, if it, for the municipality, would be a little relation, because it was a fight going for a long time there.
So it's sort of the city overcoming the desires in a way and the interests of the community at the early stages of the project, yeah?
Yes, yeah. And also, but some of the things I think we, both community and us, and also the municipality, because it's not that the municipality was a bad one,
no.
They were fighting,
yeah.
Was conflict.
Yeah.
Because there was not another way to be in that case, in that moment. But, for instance, the equipment, the community was asking the municipality, demanding the municipality to have the equipment. They never imagined that the equipment could be underneath the unit, because, well, they wanted the equipment as a separate entity. They were not imagined.
Equipment is as like the nursery and the
health center.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. We have time for one more question.
I have something for that.
Yeah, we just have one more time for one more question.
Okay.
Thank you. Martha, as I know you have been working both on the housing projects but also on urban upgrade programs, my question is a little bit on what's your opinion about both these different choices on how to deal and tackle with urban favela problems, let's say. And I would also love to hear about how these programs are being held in Cape Town or in South Africa. Because I think we have been having this cycling discussion about it, like we can track incremental housing and urban upgrade discussions from the 50s in Peru, and we are now again talking about it, or maybe it's a long line that has never been really interrupted. So would you have a straight opinion about it, or do you think it's a case? Each case deserves a different looking strategy. It would be better if it's not a housing project, if it's a urban upgrade program, or yes, that's the right decision to make a housing project. That's the question.
You first.
In South Africa, we sit in a curious position in that we've had government policies of subsidized housing, not unlike what I've seen in Brazil, except the government cannot afford it. So there's a promise that every family earning a certain amount of money will get a subsidized government house. But people sit a lifetime on lists hoping for one, and they don't get it. And the influx into the cities are greater than the pace at which these houses are built. It is a crisis. So the idea of self-built housing and incremental housing or assisted housing, all of those sorts of things, of course, making a very big comeback, simply because that is what the government can afford in dispensing its constitutional duty of providing decent housing to some extent. But we are particularly concerned with the neglect of the superstructure of the city, they call it the infrastructure, because there's such a focus on the house and the individual unit and dwelling as opposed to, say, business. You know, so people construct space for people to sleep and have dinner in and cook in, but they don't necessarily construct spaces for people to for economic opportunity or for socialization. So, I mean, the presentation that we did at the Shenzhen Biennale dealt with this thing of the construction of opportunity. So we said that the construction of infrastructure is important as the construction of opportunity. So, you know, we are very concerned about debates around housing that focuses on the house, and that is, that's old hat as well. Turner said as well, but the idea is that we must make a structure for the city that accommodates living, working, and socialization, and not just residential opportunities.
Yes, and also you said about working favelas or more urban scale. In fact, I think it's all the same question that's on the table, because in São Paulo, the infrastructure, in case of Jardim Edith, the money, because the government hasn't got many money as well. In case of Jardim Edith, it was the urban operation of Águas Espraiadas that made the money to appear, because the private sector were much more interested in this area. The question was, in Águas Espraiadas and Jardim Edith, where was the first thing that the government put the money to make? Because they choose, for instance, to make this scandalous, horrible bridge instead of making just the crossing as it needs to be, or something like that, instead of invest more money in the housing process, for instance. But in the end, I think it's always talking about which kind of city you are going to create, actually. Because the infrastructure, as the way it is conceived, is disastrous. You saw the river, the canal with two expressways each side. No urban quality at all. So even in Paraisópolis or even in Jardim Edith, I think it's always almost the same discussion. That is how you make a city with quality, with, and sometimes it's not necessarily more money, it's just question, because the government put lots of money in infrastructure for PCMOs, for instance. It's a, PCMO is a big reservoir.
It's like a water reservatory for rainwater to retain.
To retain rainwater. And it's a disaster because they build what technically is necessary. Okay, retains water. But in terms of urbanity, it's absolutely a disaster. So it's a lot of money. And it's a lot of money that is put on the peripheric areas to solve a problem that's in the center of the city. And there is not a preoccupation of invest that money in create a city. So I think it's...
Just maybe like to echo some of the comments on the panel that in terms of housing, one can see in a city like Cape Town, housing is kind of the instrument for a huge urban catastrophe in a way, in terms of how people were sort of housed for the purposes of labor practices only, or the purpose of being periphery of Cape Town has become racialized. And housing is integral in terms of how the city can be cleared and how, in a way, networks of people, ecologies, and not just the built fabric, but we're talking about sort of very entangled social networks that have been taken out of the city. So when one thinks about a commercial project, or a housing project, or an educational intervention in the city, I think one needs to develop a sensitivity into how to embed those or begin to reconstruct those kinds of lost networks as well. So whether it's a housing project, I think one needs to think about how can we reconstruct networks of care, networks of neighborhood, networks of social imagination within the projects that you're working with. So I think for me, housing in a way is kind of maybe one of the key ways of incorporating, pairing those kind of very sort of inequalities of the city. And one can either begin to think of housing as to continue some of those violent practices, or one can think about it as a way of recuperating and restoring spatial justice.
Great.
So I want to thank our panelists.
Thank you.